In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Christmas, the festival of Christmas, for some 2,000 years, has signified all over the world the remembrance of the birth of Jesus Christ. And there is no reason whatsoever why that meaning should be diminished or impeded. From time to time, according to our Gnostic tradition, messengers of the light, embodiments of the supreme light, come into the world to refresh our memories of the eternal home from whence we have come and whither we are going, and to bring to us various forms of spiritual assistance for the accomplishment of that end. And it would seem to be, according to various sources, historical sources, that somewhere around the year 100 AD, one such messenger came into the world, and that he came to be known as Jesus the Anointed. And in his wake, there came to be founded and practiced the Christian tradition, which, when all is said and done, was certainly not worse than any other traditions, and perhaps in many ways better, has done the world a great deal of good. Nowadays there is a lot of talk about, there's always talk about all kinds of things, but you know, about slavery. It was the coming of Christendom that did away with slavery in the Roman Empire and in its all various appendages. Of course, it's a nasty old custom that sort of reasserts itself in various parts of the world. But certainly it had been up to the Christian tradition, it would not have revived and would not have continued. Many, many good things came into existence as the way of this tradition. At the same time, and I'm not taking away from the merits of our Christian tradition, but let us also keep in mind, and this is in complete conformity with the way great and holy things happen in history and in the world. At this time of the year, in many places, and for a very, very long time, great festivals have been held, which in their keynote certainly had some features in common with the mystery of the birth of Christ. Beginning with at the cosmic level, and I'm not one of these cosmic guys, as you know. Why? Because Gnostics, really, when all is said and done, are not all that interested in the cosmos. Gnostics are interested in what is beyond the cosmos, where the cosmos and we ourselves come from, and where we are going. But the cosmos is full of symbolism. I love the starry sky. I have a great affection for the moon, and I get mildly excited over great conjunctions, just such as the one that we had. So, you know, beginning with the annual date of the winter solstice, there have always been all kinds of important dates of different traditions that have been put to this part of the year. Christian church fathers themselves very blandly state and confess that they picked the date of Christmas, the 25th of December by our calendar, because it was the great festival of the initiatory god Mitra. He said the Mitraists celebrate the coming of Mitra at this time. Why shouldn't we celebrate Christ at the same time? rather sensible people, I would say, a quality that was not always shared by all church fathers, I dare say, then or later. So there are all kinds of powerful, mysterious symbols and significant meanings that converge at this particular time of the year, and that really all have to do in different ways, whether you look at it from a stellar and a cosmic point of view, or whether you look at it from the more specific points of view, they all have to do with the coming of the light. Not just the physical light, which is supposed to very, very slowly start now after the winter solstice, but the greater light. The light from whence we have come, the light to which we aspire, and the light which is present in miniature, deeply within us, the Christ in us, the hope of glory. And so it is really up to us as to how deeply we live the mythos and how we address ourselves to a significant, beautiful event like Christmas. If we do the work as we ought to, then there will be an interior birth of the Christ Spirit within us. Because that is what needs to happen in us. That's what it is all about. So that the light from above, the spark of the divine flame, as it hides within us, comes forth and becomes more active, and then becomes our guiding light into the future, until it leads us to our eternal home, from whence aeons and aeons ago we departed, and the memory of which has lingered within us all this time, and which is the only place where we finally will find rest. And that is the eternal rest which we pray for when people put away their physical bodies. Requiem aeternam, the eternal rest, the eternal peace may come to us. And that eternal peace only comes when our little light, our little spirit, unites with the greater spirit and goes to it. Because that is what we truly want to do. We may think that we want to do this, that, or the other thing. And we have all kinds of little ancillary purposes that we follow in this world. But that is the great purpose. We want to go home. It's been a long time. It's been an exceedingly long time. Need to, if possible, in some ways combine the convergence of all of these meanings that we can find if we want to look them up. Our good friend and my good friend and teacher, Mr. Manly Palmer Hall, wrote two beautiful little booklets, small books, on the meaning of Christmas. They have now been reissued in a combined form. I was reading them again. And a good friend of ours of many years, who is now living in Turkey, wrote the introduction to it. And you find there all these various meanings in different traditions, but Mr. Hall brings it down to, you know, they all mean the same thing. Their meaning is that we need to participate in the sacred, bring forth the sacred from ourselves, and then we will have fulfilled the purpose of our existence. So as Angelus Silesius, the German medieval mystic, said in a longer poem, to Christ 1,000 times in Bethlehem be born, but not in thee, thy soul is all forlorn. So we have the good fortune as Gnostics and as students of these matters to that our attention has been called how important that internal birth, that Bethlehem in our souls is, and how we ought to reverently approach it. Like the Magi of old, like perhaps others, and by reverently approaching it, increasing the ability of that yet small, maybe infant light to grow into a great big flame that devours all darkness, devours all unsavory things, and leads us unto itself. And just one little item, which is just really part of the big picture, I will mention now very quickly, because it's been mentioned by Mr. Hall and in the introduction to Mr. Hall's book, and that is this, that people say, well, you know, sort of, those books were written by Manly P. Hall in the 1950s, but they sort of foreshadow the spirit of the 60s. You know? People say, well, every day is sacred, you know. Why do we make Christmas sacred? Why do we make other days holy days? They are all sacred. And my friend who introduced it was, believe it or not, even quoted Moore saying that, what you need to do is go out on the sacred earth, on the sand, draw a circle, and you say, this circle is sacred. Because, and he didn't quote that part of it, but I think it's not a bad little saying, that when everything is sacred, nothing is sacred. And so there has to be something sacred, see? You have to specify. And that is why there are these, you know, very well worked out sacred traditions in the world, whether they are Buddhists, whether they are Hindu, or whether they are Christian, whether they are Jewish, they are specific and they say, this is sacred, contemplate it. Why? Because through that contemplation and the recognition of the sacred that is before you, this is what will lead you to sacredness as such. Otherwise, it's an intellectual exercise. It's just in your mind. Oh yeah, you know, every day is sacred. Yeah, sure. But what are you doing with it? Well, you can't do anything with it because it's everywhere. It's too much. Yeah. That's why this is what the tradition does. This is what the sacred magic does. It picks out something appropriate, and then concentrates on that. Just like in the meditation exercises of some traditions, you concentrate on the mandala and on the center of the mandala, you know? Not anywhere. You don't concentrate on the, on the cars going by. And the reason I mention that is because, and I really shouldn't mention this because it's such a silly incident, but I, in the days of my greater mobility, I used the RTD or whatever it was called in those days, the bus system in Los Angeles, a great deal. So here I was on the bus, and I was going quite a long way somewhere out there toward Pasadena. And I always carried a book, of course. So in my lap, I had a book on symbolism of Indian tradition from India. And in it was the Sri Yantra, one of the very famous big mandalas. And I sat there in the bus looking at the Sri Yantra, and you know what? It became alive, and I sort of went into it, and I went way past my destination on the bus, and I said, oi, 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 how am I going to get back to where I wanted to go? Because it just took me out. There was a little sacred space on a page of a book on the bus that really could do a number on you, and it did. So that's a little example of how the sacred day, the holy day, the sacred space, the sacred symbol, the icon, the Blessed Sacrament, of course, above all, how they can become openings into an ineffable greatness. And once they do that, then we are on the way to great and to wonderful things. And so we need to continue to be grateful that this particular holy day, in the darkness of winter, when the light just begins to come back, has been given us. And that with it has been connected the coming of the Helper, the coming of the one. I was listening to the wonderful harp music of our dear friend whom we welcome after a year of having been here. She made me hum and sing the old German Christmas songs and Hungarian Christmas songs that I learned a long time ago. When we look at these many of these songs, and the very famous one in the German tongue, the Stille Nacht, Heilige Nacht, quiet night, holy night, you find it there that something very great and very mysterious is happening. And this, as we are led to that great and mysterious thing, we are reconnected with something. We are given a glimpse to going home. We are given a glimpse to that placeless place from whence we have come. And whither, with God's help and the help of the great messengers of light, and certainly of our Lord Jesus Christ, we shall come and we shall return. And so, let's try to be open to these things. We live in a society that changes like nobody's business, and in the change, experiences unprecedented, pestilences and all kinds of misery. That's kind of an age which we live in. But in that age, still we have to look for the sacred. Not for the political excitement, not for any other kind of excitement, not for money, but for that mysterious thing, that light that flows through the cracks. It's there. When you come, you think it's all just mundane, but hiding behind the mundane and shining through the mundane is the sacred. That is what is important. That is what we have to contemplate. That is what we have to help to bring back into this world. Not anything else. We have become materialists. We have become secularists. We have become maybe not deniers of the deity, because that's atheism, like we had among the Soviets. But you know what? We have become ignorers of the divine. We don't deny it, but we ignore it. Be careful. When you do that, when you push the sacred out of your chamber, it leaves a vacuum. Haven't you heard that nature abhors a vacuum? The super nature abhors a vacuum too. What comes in is not good. What comes in is very dark. What comes in is the demonic that has all kinds of aspects, and among others, brings pestilences and various things to kill us. Yes. So what's the answer? Ultimately, there is only one answer. That one answer is the divine. That answer is the divine light that comes to us and is within us already. And if we follow that light, it's not a will-o'-the-wisp. Everything else is a will-o'-the-wisp. Everything else is false, I assure you. Science is false, politics is false, art is false, unless it is sanctified, then it's different. Everything else is false. There's only one thing that's real, and that's the divine. And this is the time when we can be closer to that, when we can contemplate its coming to us and be grateful for it and try to enliven that within ourselves. And so may the mystery of that which hangs with heaven and earth descend upon us and remain with us always. Amen.